Martin Scorsese, the man and his movies, now on BBC Two. The acclaimed director talks to Mark Cousins in New York.
The American filmmaker Martin Scorsese, who made Taxi Driver and Raging Bull and Goodfellas, loves nothing better on a day like today than sitting down and watching movies, which is great, except there's one type of movie that he doesn't like watching very much, and that's his own, which makes today very special. The idea is to get deeper into the world of Martin Scorsese movies, and we're going to film it all and you're going to see it all.
There's something magical about when a film goes through a projector and you hear it go through the projector and you see that beam of light. I remember visiting some relatives of mine when I was about 4 years old, and this older gentleman had a 16-millimeter projector, and they screened a black and white cartoon for me. And it was fascinating to see that the images were coming from this machine with this puff of light and this hot scent, this hot light, and the sense of the dust and the beam. And I looked at the film and I saw all these little pictures on it. It was absolutely fascinating, you know. So I think he was more interested in how the machine was working too, yeah, than the actual images on the screen.
But isn't it interesting that some people are not fascinated by that? Some people just don't get that.
It's the most magical moment when you hear the whirring of the projector and you hear the clicking of the film going through, especially a silent film when there's nothing playing. You just hear that projector going. It creates a whole other dream world. It's like a church, yeah. And it's much more important than the magic time that's created, I think. Much more powerful to me than the magic time that's created in theater, for example. For me, theater is too real.
Yeah. There's no close-ups in theater.
There's no close-ups. It's too immediate. A good actor is going to make you see a close-up. That's for sure. Yeah. You know, sometimes you go to theater and it doesn't matter what the play is, but one or two of these actors are just so powerful that they're an extreme close-up for you all the way through, you know. Yeah. But there's something about the sense of an immediacy there that is a little off-putting for me. But that's not a put-down of the theater. That's just because my first association's always been with moving images, film.
So like when you're sitting here or when you're sitting at home and you're imagining...
I never sit here. This is an office. You don't make films in an office.
So you only do business here?
I don't even want to do business here. I don't come in. I haven't been here 2 weeks. The editing room is in there, and that's a back way into the editing room. I usually go in and sneak in the back way. I don't want to walk down there. There's too much business going on.
So I have
a little room in the top of my townhouse, a little den.
We were talking there about your childhood and some of the influences. Now, in your film After Hours,
yes,
there's a scene where Griffin Dunne's character talks about visiting hospital, and he tells a story about going to hospital and getting a tonsillectomy.
Oh, really?
Is that based on your own life?
No, I don't remember it. Is it in the film? Do you have it here?
Are you Jewish? You know it's in it.
No, a tonsillectomy.
But he talks about going to hospital. Well, let's look and see.
Isn't where he's massaging Kiki? Oh, yeah, of course. And she falls asleep. Yeah.
Had you forgotten about that?
I forgot. I remember the scene. I forgot what he was saying.
I know. When I was a kid, I had my tonsils taken out.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah, I forgot about that.
And after the operation, they didn't have enough room in pediatrics, so they had to put me in the burn ward. Well, before they wheeled me in, this nurse gave me this blindfold to put on. She told me never to take it off. If I did, I'd have to do the operation all over again. That night. At least I think it was night. I reached up to untie the blindfold. And...
this is a whole sensual thing about it. It's kind of nice. That's his luck. That's it. His whole life is going to be that way. The lost moment for his entire life, basically.
But my point of putting this on here was that I heard that happened to you.
Well, what had happened to me was, again, as I say, my parents were not educated people. I'm intelligent, but not educated. So in 1945, I think it was, apparently I had to have my tonsils taken out. And I didn't want to go. So my mother said, go with the nurse. She'll take you to the circus. And I remember being put on what I thought was an ironing board. and having the mask put on and being told to count ten backwards. And I don't remember anything after that, but my mother said apparently when she came to visit me afterwards, I didn't speak to her for 3 days.
Because you felt she lied to you by
Absolutely,
telling
I
you you were
going
to have a nice experience and you had a traumatic one.
And to this day, I really don't like the circus.
The next clip I've got on this table here is from a documentary you made called Italian American, which several times you said was your best film. Why did you say that?
What happened with it was that I began to realize that it's really character. I like character-driven films, and they reveal a lot about their character in the movie.
Your mom and dad?
Yes. The camera records them and doesn't intrude. And I found that was interesting, that ultimately, you know, the most extraordinary thing in a frame is a human being, especially when they're able to communicate emotions to you, or humor, or sadness, or whatever, any kind of emotion, and you get to know them by watching their faces on the screen. You know, you don't have to have the camera tracking upside down and go down to the copa, you know, going to the copa, the back of the copa. That's something else. That has its place in a picture. Sometimes I feel the pictures I make, the camera, sometimes may not be moving, may be intruding, you know. I'm not sure, you know.
Now I'm putting my patch in. Much
in. He's rolling, big. Oh.
We should slate it, don't you think? Yeah.
Rolling.
Well, this was the very first thing we shot.
Okay, is that the light?
Where are you sitting down there? Why are you
and I thought,
down there?
I thought that they could warm up.
Why are you so far
from but instead they took over the whole thing.
Oh, yeah,
so
then,
you know, that's basically up.
No, you come here. That's it. That's more like it. Lovey-dovey sort of, you know. They say as you get older, your love grows stronger. So for some reason, it is getting a little stronger, you know. Right, Daddy? He's bashful.
Yeah, I know. Well, you were going to tell us about the sauce. You were going to show us how to do the sauce.
Well, what should I say?
Well, you're going to get up and show it to us, but I wanted to know who, you know, how did you learn it?
Well, what are you asking?
About the sauce.
Italian American and then watch a film like Raging Bull, for example, those domestic scenes in Raging Bull have a real feel.
Well, that's it. That's exactly. All the non-fight scenes come right out of the Italian American film.
Hmm. Documentary, basically.
Documentary. If you notice, the non-fighting scenes in the film, there isn't that much camera movement. It's pretty much setting the scene and letting the people work. Letting the people, not the actors, but the people, they're the characters. They're there, and they are placed in their environment, and just let them be. You know, medium shot, close up sometimes, three shot, just to see the baby at the table in the famous, the breakfast scene, which I always liked, where he tells him...
And the fixing the TV scene
The fixing
as well.
The TV scene is very important, where it starts out a little wider in medium shots and then gets a little closer, just a little closer, not a lot.
Smile with you, huh? What's with this kissing on the mouth?
I just said hello. Can I kiss my sister-in-law?
And is she good enough for you? I don't even kiss mom on the mouth the way you kiss. All of a sudden, you're like a Romeo.
So you're not supposed to kiss your mother on the mouth?
That's what I'm talking about. How's that?
That looks like something. Get back. I can't see nothing with your stomach in the way now. What are you giving me dirty looks for?
What I mean by the camera changes position is that it's a two-shot of us right now. This way, let's say. And at a certain point in the dialogue, the camera moves over to the or to our right a little bit, favoring me just a little bit.
Yeah.
Why at that point? Mm-hmm. You see? Mm-hmm. And you learn that, and I tell you, you could do it. You just take it apart. It's quite interesting. Watch Dial M for Murder, Hitchcock. Mm-hmm. Watch the dialogue scenes. You could see changing camera positions at certain points in time. And then, why in that line of dialogue? I see. You know, it's a implication of some sort where he's intensifying. Mm-hmm.
But you don't regret, for example, that move in Taxi Driver when he's on the phone and you move to the right?
No, not at all. No.
Because that's an unmotivated move in a way?
It's an emotionally motivated move because it's too painful to watch him go through that humiliation on the phone. And the camera moves as if to pick up somebody in the hall, but there's nobody in the hall.
A cup of coffee. I come by the headquarters or something. We could... Okay. Did you get my flowers in the... You didn't get them. But I sent some flowers.
That was the very first shot I thought of in the film. And I said, that's the style of the picture.
Okay, okay.
I know what you're saying. I'm aware now that the camera's moving. But that's okay because of his intensity. Mm-hmm. Travis can handle obvious camera moves, you know. Wells did that when I saw Citizen Kane for the first time on television. I realized I saw what a director does, a certain kind of director. Because I had still liked John Ford films, and I realized, well, I wasn't aware of the camera there, but yet I was aware of the image. Ah, now what's the difference between the image of Ford and what's the difference to the image of Wells? You know, both equally valid, both brilliant. You know, one's a poetic view, another is something else. There's something else going on. You had Godard in the 60s reinventing cinema constantly, every movie, until he finally said, I had enough of it. It wasn't important in the first place.
Making life in cinema equivalent,
totally.
You know?
And yeah, well, that's
it's like at the end of your film, Last Temptation, Christ's life runs out in a way, and the movie runs out at
the
same
ran
time.
Out.
It didn't
movie.
Really.
Well,
the
did.
Film didn't really
The film
out.
Did. The film did, because what happened that day, that particular shot that day, it would be the one, that particular shot, there was a problem. We were shooting so fast. There was a problem when they put the magazine back on. Somehow, when they took it off, they had leaked a little light into it, and that was the take I liked best. He said, and that was the take I liked best. And I said, well, then by all means, let's just let the whole thing run out to edge fog.
It is a cult.
Later in the 60s, you went to NYU, you got married, you started your own filmmaking, you started teaching filmmaking, you made a film called The Big Shave.
Yes, now that was not out of a student situation, that was out of Angry Arts Against Vietnam Week, it was called.
There's a funny contradiction, I think, because in the 60s you weren't the most trendy of people, you know, you were still living
at
home.
I was
you
pretty much still living at home.
Home.
Parents, yeah.
You were behind the times in
totally
some way.
Totally behind it. I was pretty much from the... We were like living in a little Sicilian village.
Yeah.
I had sensed something having gone to NYU. I sensed something, NYU being on the west side of Manhattan in Greenwich Village, where things were a little more freer, a little more open. I began to get more open-minded, began to meet people who were not Italian-Americans, who came from all different parts of the world, and hearing all these different viewpoints, and that's when I began to understand certain things politically.
It feels very anguished.
No, not really.
No.
I was angry, I think. Uh-huh. I've always been angry, I think, and... I was pretty angry, but when the film was shown, it got major laughs. And I said, my God, it was meant to get laughs, but I said, don't be silly, take him. You know, you know, take him, enjoy him, because the laughter is also very nervous. And they get, plus the laughing and booing and hissing and people throwing things at the screen, it happened here at Lincoln Center. You have to build up to it, you cheated.
This is Raging Bull. That's a Raging Bull. That shot, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
I never got over getting that shot. Yeah.
But what happens here is very interesting.
I just ran out of music.
But then you go.
Oh, the red. Yeah.
Red.
To red. Yeah. Yeah.
And
exactly.
Again, and particularly in your movies of the 90s, I think more than before, like in Age of Innocence and Cape Fear, you do that full frame color, don't you?
Yeah, but I think, you know, I just got tired of trying to be subtle about it. I guess I happen to like the color red, and so I want to use it.
But also and, yellow in Age of Innocence.
Yellow in Age of Innocence, because the flowers. Yeah, the flowers. Yellow, feeling of life, growth, something precious, something alive, you know. And this incredible power, passion that he had for her, and she had for him. It was something quite beautiful. Perfect for that. But that comes right out of Black Narcissus. It's the extraordinary flash, I think, of red or orange when Kathleen Byron collapses, and then everything fades. And then suddenly you're back in. And
it's like
fantastic.
Your whole world is suddenly...
Whole, yep, you see, you actually it creates a feeling of actually what it feels like to faint.
Yeah.
You know, and lose consciousness.
Yeah.
And it did it visually. It was quite something. But it was such a shock to see that color come up. But why not? I mean, just do it. You know, throw the color up there on the screen. The color is emotion,
And then you moved to LA, you did Woodstock, it was successful. Yeah. Did you get an Oscar for Woodstock?
No, Thelma got nominated.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah. I was an editor under her.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I was not nominated.
And famously, you went to Woodstock wearing cufflinks.
Yes. Michael Wadley got the, Bob Maurice, who produced the picture, got the Oscar. Uh-huh. Yes, I wore cufflinks, French cuffs.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. You still hadn't grown your hair.
No, I hadn't grown it too long. Yeah.
And you went to L.A. and you got into, apparently you bought a poster from 2 weeks for another town.
2 weeks for another town I put over my bed, yeah.
As an intent saying, I will not stay here anytime.
Freddie Weintraub, who was the vice president of Warner Brothers at the time, he had this rock and roll film he wanted me to edit because I was one of the editors of Woodstock. And he said, listen, don't come out for 2 weeks, you know, I won't screw you too bad. At least he said he was going to screw me. So, you know, at least he was upfront about it. And went out for 2 weeks and stayed for 13 years.
And you did Boxcar Bertha.
Yes.
Which is one of the few films of yours that I don't like. I hope it's okay to say that.
That's all right. I'm not that fond of it either. But what it was a way of learning how to make a picture. You see, up to this point, there was no schedules. There was no production, you see. In other words, we shot when we had the camera, and if the actors were still talking to us, you know. And please, begging favors from people. Whereas Boxcar Bertha, where you started on a Monday and 24 days later you finished, you know, 6 days a week, and that's it. And you have a certain amount of shots to get certain before lunch, and you better get them. And that's a very important thing. Without having done Boxcar, there's no way I could have done Mean Streets.
Sure.
Yeah.
So you did Mean Streets, and it made you a star in the way, did it? Your phone started ringing all the time, you got loads of scripts offered to you and everything.
That's what they
tell
me, yeah.
And did you want to be famous? Did you want to be...
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yes.
And
yeah.
Did all that generation of people that you met then, Spielberg and Schrader and...
We all did. I mean, when I was at NYU, I know I was a director. I was making a living editing somewhat, other people's films and documentaries and things like that. I was making a living also doing a little bit of writing, but basically, the only thing I really can't do is on my own. I tried. I have no knowledge of any kind of lighting or camera work, how a camera works. I've tried that. I've done 16mm and things like that, but I'm not... Where I came from, it was always dark.
So do you leave it always to your DOP?
It was
DOP?
Always dark in the lower... Yeah, well, pretty much the DP. No, I design with him. I design the shots. I design the movement of the shots and the size of the frame. I have a real problem sometimes dealing with the light. I don't know where the light sometimes is coming from. For me, like, it's New York. Look at us right now. Just turn a light on. What do you want? You want the sun to be shining through here? It's absurd. You know, don't tell me you want smoke in the light, too. You know, it doesn't happen in my office, you know, or in the editing room. You know, put a tungsten light on. What do I care? I mean, it's like it's part of the type. But yet, I also saw the light, for example, that Roger Deakins understood, which was the light from the butter lamps in Kundun, you see. Darkness and the greasy walls and that sort of thing. That was very important. But no, I felt I was a director, and I knew I was, but other people didn't take me that seriously. And I was shameless. I went to every party in L.A., promoted myself shamelessly. Dreadful
person. As a self-confessed working-class person, did you have the confidence?
Oh, I was a working-class person, but I never worked.
Yeah.
My parents did the working. They gave me money to go to school.
Yeah.
I had asthma. I was taken care of. You know,
but one of the things about working-class people
is... Take care of I was like a crazy filmmaker. Yeah. I wanted to make movies.
But there's this issue of confidence. So many working-class people maybe don't have the confidence, don't think that their voice is important enough to
be heard by
everybody.
I don't know why. You're absolutely right. I have no idea why I thought, you know, I just was burned with the passion of these moving images and the emotions I saw growing up around me, and to sort of combine the two. I don't know how else to do it.
Wow. Okay, let's look at a bit of Mean Streets here.
Hallelujah. I've come to create order. Carl, J&B and soda, please. May God be with you.
Well, that's just the first chapter of Ulysses.
Let me ask you something.
What?
Art thou the king of the Jews?
Dost thou say this of thyself, or have others told thee of me?
Am I a Jew?
My kingdom is not of this world.
So you had read James Joyce at the time as making Mean Streets.
I didn't understand it, but I understood more. I identified more with, well, of course, Portrait of the Artist and Dubliners, you know, the Dubliners. But here is basically, you know, we sat around. These things were said. Quotes from the scriptures came out all the time. People spoke that way, you know.
That's extraordinary.
Not necessarily as clearly as this in this particular scene, but you know, the gods, the saints were called upon. If people had, I never forget, one woman who was a friend of ours one day says, I'm not praying to the Virgin Mary anymore. I am sick of praying to her. I have asked her 1,000 times for this favor, and it hasn't happened. I'm refused. And my friend and I say, well, that'll show the Virgin Mary. <That's>, that will show her. You know, I mean, this is very real. This is all very real. I mean, this is part of it. And so in the film, it goes off a little bit on the deep end, and that has a lot to do with seeing a lot of Italian films. But again, it's Italian. You see, Acatone, and they always talk about one incredible scene, Acatone, where... Pasolini's film, where a character says to Acatone, and when Acatone stops being a pimp, he says to him, he says, today you'll sell your watch, tomorrow you'll sell your gold chain, and in a week you won't have eyes to cry with.
Quanto vuoi? Ho pagato 15.000, avevo metà a metà, 7.000. Oggi la vita mi sorride, ve voglio fare dura a voi. Approfittate. Accattù, senti quello che ti dice il profeta. Oggi ti viene l'anello, domani la catenina, fra 7 giorni pure l'orologio, e fra 77 giorni non ci avrai nemmeno l'occhi per piangere.
It's just poetry, you know? I mean, it's... And I say unto you, he says, like the Bible, you won't have eyes to cry with. You know, and it's just like, this is what I heard growing up. I mean, I don't understand a lot of the, especially Ulysses, but then you do get to understand. I mean, I have a little reader's guide, and I'm getting through it a second time now, and, you know, but there's no doubt that the irreverence of Buck Mulligan has a lot to do with, what we were, a lot of, because it wasn't just reverence, but a lot of it was very irreverent about religion.
And also
and
one of
cursing the saints and cursing God for the situation we're in and the people in the streets. It was a constant thing. It was very alive.
And this is James Joyce's idea of escaping the nets of religion, as he put it, and that sense of your characters often trying to escape the neighborhood all that.
Absolutely.
Right, we've got another scene here from Mean Streets. It's the drunk scene. I just want to know how you did it.
Do that again.
He had a body brace under his jacket that you use for an Aeroflex camera that the cameraman would put on him and then put the camera on the body brace. But instead, we put a board at the end of it and put the camera on the end of a board. And there was a guy walking backwards holding it because the board would bounce, you see. So he was holding it.
Was the kind of a sandwich that you're supposed to take? 2 pieces of bread and wish you had some meat.
And finally, when it went on the ground, it went sideways with him. See? And now he just like a ballet dancer,
he eased himself down.
Yeah, just eased himself down like that way, sideways with him.
It's the best. I think it's the best drunk scene in the movies.
Well, that's what it felt like. Sort of felt like some of those nights.
Then you made a film which seemed to take American cinema by the scruff of the neck, which was Taxi Driver. Can we look at the beginning and can you describe?
Brian De Palma gave me the script, and he was a friend of Paul Schrader's, and I loved the script. Now, this wasn't in the script, this coming through the smoke. But this is part of what I see in the city all the time, and it's one of the last shots we got on the movie, actually. And I decided that that's where the picture should open. A couple of critics, from one critic, felt that it was the metaphors, New York as hell, he said, that's about as deep as the film gets. And I didn't mean it for that. I didn't mean it as a metaphor of any kind. It's just the image of this impending danger coming through the smoke, you know, but these are wise guys, what can you do? And this is sort of the eyes here, it's always reminded me of the look of the eyes of De Niro here, and also later on in the film, he's looking in the mirror, in the rearview mirror, very much taken from the close-ups of eyes of Tales of Hoffman, of Robert Helpman. And this image reminds me very much of the opening credits of The Small Back Room, a black and white film that Paul Pressburger did. And these images were shot by David Nichols, a friend of mine. He went out and shot Second Unit for me, and I designed the shots and asked him to do it a certain way. But in any event, here's the sort of Robert Helpman, Tales of Hoffman thing. But it isn't like you tell Robert De Niro, say, Bob, now think of Robert Helpman. You know, it has no idea, you know.
What did you tell him there?
I just said, just looking from left to right, and it was a matter of shooting at high speeds. And sometimes I'd shoot at 36, 32, or 48, or 54, and that sort of thing. So then I'd find the one that I liked most and use that. But they're like references in my mind. They aren't direct references to the movies that they're inspired by, but they're kind of a fuel in a way that spurs my imagination to move a little further, you know.
This was a very low point in your life, wasn't it, Martin?
Yeah.
You did New York, New York first, and then Raging Bull, which was done near here somewhere.
Yeah. When I was living in an apartment building right over there, we did Raging Bull across the street, edited right across the street over there,
yeah,
in this place called the Galleria.
Was that a production office?
No, I was living there. We were editing the film out of there. I was editing on the 32nd floor. Huh. I didn't go out. Just lived there.
We'll
and worked
that.
At night, yes.
I recall every fall, every hook, every jab. The worst way a guy can get rid of his phleb. As you know, my life wasn't drab. Though I'd rather hear you cheer when you delve, I delve into Shakespeare. A horse, a horse, my kingdom for a horse. I haven't had a winner in 6 months. Though I'm no Olivier, I would much rather.
It's very Italian, this movie, very like Italian cinema, this Raging Bull.
Why?
The black and white framing. Here, the light bulbs here, this, him here. You know, it's inspired by a lot of the Italian films of the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s.
That's entertainment.
Jake LaMotta and Jimmy Reeves in the Cleveland Arena. LaMotta is undefeated, but he's well behind on points.
And at this time, at the time of Raging Bull, you became more interested in film conservation and in collecting films, I think.
Yeah, sure enough, this little library we have inside of a few thousand tapes comes across really importantly, not only for myself but for lots of other filmmakers and writers, and people ask and call up if I have some obscure film just by chance. The only copy we have of The Passion of Joan of Arc, for example, was off Channel 13 here in New York 20 years ago, and it's still pretty good enough for us to make a copy to send to Sharon Stone to look at. You know what I'm saying? And she said it was great. You know, she didn't notice any blemish in it at all. It was fairly, I mean, it's not the film.
She playing Joan of Arc?
No, she was just interested in this in this Madame Falconetti idea, this whole idea, this extraordinary close-ups. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, between, I'm just saying her, but I know other people, Woody Allen, a number of people have asked for tapes and of certain films, obscure things that you just can't get anymore.
Yeah.
Even though, you know, practically everything we think is on Laserdisc or video now or DVD, but it's not quite that. It isn't quite as. There's some very key films that are not, for example, Passion of Joan of Arc, and it's been restored too. There should be, you know, we should have a laser disc of it. That's not happening. So, anyway,
let's move on.
Yes, move on.
One of your best films of the 1990s was Goodfellas. Now, its style is completely different, isn't it? It's like twice as fast as New York, New York. Why is it so fast, and where did you get the new style from?
The new style comes purely from, I should say, comes from a pure state of excitement. How I first really heard, like the famous storytellers, where you would have storytellers go from village to village in the old world. Well, a lot of guys would stand on street corners, where I was from, and some were excellent storytellers, funny and self-deprecating, and conjure up images so quickly, you know. And they were tough kids, very tough people. And I'd always say, boy, imagine to make a film with that kind of speed and excitement and humor, which makes the way of life in the film at first extremely romantic and appealing. But then, of course, one begins to pay for it, and you begin to see what the lifestyle really is about. You know, just a dead end, a moral, spiritual dead end, you know. And in some cases, just death, totally death. I mean, people are killed, put away in jail, you know, it's just a joke. And the life expectancy, the early 20s, late 20s, that sort of thing. But in any event, I'd also got a little annoyed by the aspect that was happening in American films, where things had to go faster and faster. I said, well, if you want it fast, I'll give it to you really fast. Let's go real fast on this one. And because that's the lifestyle, it is fast. And you suddenly, yes, true, you get stopped by a bullet or a bat in the head or a cop putting you in jail, in and out of jail. But, you know, up to that point, it's pretty fast, and you have a great time.
And what I've got here is the ending of the picture, yeah. Where he has ratted on his colleagues, yeah. And now he has to go and live in isolation in,
yes,
suburbia.
Now,
what's,
yeah,
the tone of this ending?
The tone of it is like, you know, he has the nerve to be complaining. And you're watching this. Well, what do you feel about it?
Today everything is different. There's no action. I have to wait around like everyone else. Can't even get decent food. Right after I got here, I ordered some spaghetti with marinara sauce, and I got egg noodles and ketchup.
I remember Paul Schrader telling me, Marty, you know, you should have that change, that ending change, said, because people don't want to be sitting there for 2 hours and 20 minutes for a guy who reacts that way at the end of the film. And I said, but that's the kind of people I kind of knew growing up. I said, I just wanted to deal with it realistically. And we dare you to get annoyed in the audience, you know? It's like a provocation of the audience, really.
Mm-hmm. And it's about the sort of mundanity of life. He's moved into a mundane world rather,
yes,
than an exciting but scary world.
You know, yeah, exactly. But, you know, I'm not saying people should live this way, but what I'm saying is that I want them to understand the thinking. And if the thinking provokes you into anger, well, that's life.
Hmm. Okay, let's have a look at it.
Didn't mean anything. When I was broke, I would go out and rob some more. We ran everything. We paid off cops.
See?
Paid off lawyers.
And everything
paid
worked
off
out.
Judges. Everybody had their hands out. Everything.
Judges, particularly. You don't tell me where I have to go because I know what you paid for that seat.
And now it's all over.
And that's the hardest part.
And there's a terrible sense of regret, too, isn't there?
Oh, but a regret for, it's ironic, because a regret for what?
Yeah, for a good life.
For his idea of a good life, which was, you know, what we had seen for the past 2 hours. It's madness. He's complaining about marinara sauce.
An average nobody. Get to live the rest of my life like a schnook.
And why that? Now, this character's already dead in the movie.
Yeah. Well, that's a reference right to the end of The Great Train Robbery. Edwin S. Porter. That's the way that ends that film. And basically, the plot of this picture is very similar to The Great Train Robbery. It hasn't changed. It's 90 years later. It's the same story. The gunshots will always be there. He's got to always look behind his back. He's got to have eyes behind his head, as they used to say, because they're going to get him someday.
So, Martin, let's talk about your new film, Kundun. It's a surprise to see this film, isn't it? Your old NYU teacher said to you, Marty, stick to what you know, and you know Manhattan, you know the wise guys in Manhattan, and you've made a film about Tibet.
Well, I think what he really meant, I think, is stick to what you know in your heart. And when you say wise guy, well, that's just the cosmetic, in a way. That's just the surface. What it has to do with trust. It has to do with a moral code between men. And I saw it enacted every day when I was growing up in the streets and in my apartment, my father, explaining what was right and what was wrong. Mm-hmm. Within every given context, in every given situation, even to the point of if food was brought to the table incorrectly by my mother. You understand? So everything had to be a certain way, and there was certain deliberation about
and
it.
And your father would object to that?
Sometimes, yes. Something wasn't brought right correct way, or, and she would let him have it, of course. There would be wonderful arguments back and forth.
That sounds scary. Was it scary?
Oh, yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. To a child, it was. Yeah, that's what I grew up with. Yeah. But it had to do with something you know, and I think Kundun, it has to do with the other side of what I saw in my 3.5 room apartment growing up with my mother and father and my brother, which was a very strong commitment to each other, a real love of a marriage that lasted 60 years. That's where Kundun comes from.
Sure. And your film Taxi Driver is seen rigorously from the...
That's that Calvinist, Paul Schrader.
It's seen rigorously from the point of view of its main character, Travis Bickle.
Yes.
And so is Kundun.
Yes.
Why did you look at it solely from the point of view of this boy growing up?
Because the outer trappings of the culture are so foreign that the only way I thought we could make a Western audience, particularly American audience, identify with it would be to deal with the people and stay within the confines of the little boy at first, and just see what the little boy sees, or hear what the little boy hears, or understand what the little boy understands, which isn't very much at first. And this way it would hook you into the way people dress, the way they eat, the rituals, daily life, everything. It would just immerse you into that culture. And if you're immersed into the culture, then it's not foreign to you anymore. They're human beings. We don't need a Westerner in there to translate these Asians for us. And that also made it quite evident that we weren't about to explain the culture
of Tibet.
We weren't about to explain Tibetan Buddhism. We weren't about to explain Tibetan history. We certainly weren't about to explain Tibetan history and China's history mixed together. Ultimately, it was an extremely difficult picture to make because we wanted to place the viewer into the spiritual rhythm of the Tibetans.
Okay, now the first clip I've got, Martin, is the scene in Kundun where the character says, "Gifts from the West." We see it's a kind of golden scene where the young boy starts to look at movies. What is that scene about?
What it is really is the beginning of the fascination that the Dalai Lama has with the West. And this world of movies opening up to him, kind of fantasy of film, where he had Méliès films, and I think this particular film was from Pathé, and also some newsreels, and eventually Henry V, or Laurence Olivier's Henry V. And here were the beginnings of the young Dalai Lama becoming enticed with elements of the West, particularly the shoes. You like the old shoes.
Did he tell you?
Yes, he always really, really did. And this particular film is the one he remembered of the women coming out of the eggs.
Oh, but they found them.
The gifts from the West. These things. The great 13th Dalai Lama.
That. And that sound. This is the film, The Hen That Laid the Golden Egg.
Had you seen it before this?
No.
Before he mentioned it?
No, but there, I've read about it over the years. This is about as close as he can get to the people in Lhasa, just looking through the telescope.
Now that thing that you do, that dissolve along the axis of the lens, that's in all your movies, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really to show you the context of where he is. We had a serious problem placing that within the sequence. I'm still not too satisfied with the way it turned out. But
why?
It may be too jarring. But I wanted the audience to see. I would have gone just to this image, but he's so small here. So we had to show him in context and then out. And one of the first cuts, I should say, like that I remember was in, I think it's Yojimbo. Where he said, "What's your name?" He says, "Greenfields," and he looks out the window. He's having tea, and he looks out to the fields, and it's a wide shot and then a tighter one. Bang, bang, like that. Yeah, I think Kurosawa imprinted that in my brain, and then Truffaut did it a lot. Yeah,
and then something happens in the film, of course, when he becomes aware of the terror that China is wreaking, and your style changes. Does it? How does it change?
What I wanted to do at that point was sort of create from that point on a kind of dreamlike effect where he's very being, understands the depth of the suffering. It's the symbol or the sign of the impending doom, which just permeates his waking state and dream state, so that the waking state and the dream state become one.
Just like a dream experience, whatever things I enjoy will become a memory. Whatever
it starts to feel really like a Scorsese picture for the last 40 minutes of the film. Once we, it feels like we go inwards in some way.
Exactly.
And we start to feel a kind of struggle. For the first time, he's felt what the world really is before he's got a slightly naive view of the world.
Yeah, slightly naive, but also the idea was that the last 40 minutes of the film could only, we felt, only work powerfully with that 1 hour and 10 minutes or so prior to it, you see. And it was a matter of, should it be 1 hour, 10 minutes, 1 hour, 8 minutes, whatever. 1 hour, 3 minutes, 1 hour, 12 minutes. We don't know. But we left it at that length in order for the rest to work, for the end to work, you see. That was the key. That was the key thing.
Okay, let's switch to the next bit. Coming up is one of the strangest shots, not only in this film, but I think in your entire career, that.
Oh, that, yeah.
Why that, like that?
I wanted to show the two guardian lions at the gate.
Oh, yeah.
And then switch over to the gate. Double framed, printed every frame twice, because it was too fast originally.
Oh, so that slows it down?
Yeah.
A safe journey.
I had imagined in his mind And when he's saying, I see a safe journey, I see a safe return, I see a safe journey is done in his mind. He sees the enclosure of the Nobilinka, you see. And I wanted to flash
pan,
which is the Summer Palace. And I wanted to flash to the first wall and track along, and flash to the second wall and track along, and flash to the third wall and track along, and flash to the fourth one, bringing it back to the gate. It turned out we didn't need all those, and we condensed it down to about three shots.
I see a safe journey.
See, and again, this turn too was edited, was done in the den. Again, bang, see, punch here. This was done in the editing room, these. And this cut, watch. Dun, dun. See?
Because of the music.
Right. And now he turns here, wide again. This I did in the editing room, that wide. Huh. I didn't know I was going to cut back to wide then.
You've said a lot, I've read lots of interviews, and you use this phrase again and again, which is, let's see and far we can how far we can push it, that idea of the extreme.
Yes.
Now, it seems to me that there's a shot in this film, which has already become famous, I think, which is the monk shot. And it seems to me that you've pushed your style of filmmaking about as far as it can go.
I don't know. I mean,
when we say
as far as we could push, it means as far as I can push it.
Yeah.
Another filmmaker may be able to take it more.
Hmm.
I don't know. But here I am trying to find other ways of giving the audience the emotions of the film, giving the audience the ideas of the picture, other ways of telling the story with images than I'm normally, than a normal story that I would do affords me, you see. I'm really trying to sort of grow with it and see if I could squeeze something out of film that I haven't done before.
The Chinese have bombed the monastery of Litang. It has been destroyed. They threw rocks from aeroplanes. Nuns and monks are made to fornicate in the streets. They put their guns in the hands of our Kampa children.
This was done at home, too.
To kill the parent.
Here. And now the camera stopped moving by the time we cut in. That took quite a while to edit, to get it right, the rhythm.
Yeah. But you knew that during that
dolly
end, you would...
Yeah, and we'd drop in three shots, maybe, and with a scream, with a gunshot, whatever. First, I knew the first shot was going to be blood splatter all over the wall. I knew that. Blood splatter. I didn't even know. I didn't even want to shoot the thing with the kid, but then I said, well, I've got to have a gunshot. Because that's what someone sees, imagination of what's happening. Now, these shots that are coming up were never there. They were not supposed to be there. They were up earlier in the film. But at this point, there's no sense in dealing with it logically.
Because it fits super. It fits very well here.
That's what I mean by music, cutting music. And here. See this?
Actually, so you had the music cues when you were editing?
Yeah, exactly. And this. Three shots.
These three shots
were meant to be much earlier in the film.
Huh.
And we moved them back here because receiving the bad news, this is the impression of the results of what's going to happen. And the hands opening is sort of like Jimmy Stewart at the end of Vertigo.
To stop the shot, but at this point, is this still all live action? Is that all real monks?
Right here.
So that's all real.
It's all real.
Real actors.
There
are people
there. Here is beginning a duplication of the same people. We took them and moved them around and shot them again.
Uh-huh. So originally, the first crane would have had empty space.
A little
around
empty space around here. Yeah, it was still pretty good. It looked pretty interesting.
And let's just watch how far it goes.
Now, you see, then he wakes up from the dream.
Hmm. Kundun reminded me in some ways of Last Temptation of Christ, but the style is different, isn't it? This Last Temptation is more of a documentary style. It's got more improvised acting, and yet it's about a religious man. It's about somebody who in some way has to find his destiny.
Well, there was no improvisation in Last Temptation. I mean, we did some rewriting during rehearsal, but it really wasn't that much improvisation. Mm-hmm. It was and more of a realistic look to it, I thought. I went through it on the basis of Jesus as dealing with the human nature, the human side of his nature, making that character totally accessible to people today. That was the idea, that if you had made it in modern dress, he'd be on 8th Avenue and 52nd Street with the whores and the pimps and crack addicts and stuff like that. He'd be hanging out there.
I've put a scene in here from Last Temptation. It's where Christ takes his heart out.
Oh, yes.
Which wasn't in the book.
That's right. That was a Paul Schrader.
Paul Schrader.
Yes. I think it had to do... I think he was baiting Catholics with the Sacred Heart imagery.
Yeah.
Because he's Calvinist. It's a very different thing. He said, well, why don't we do it, Marty? Why don't we just have them take out his heart? I said, well, that's what it is. See, when he takes out the heart... I grew up with that picture all around. Yeah. I always looked at the heart, the Sacred Heart of Jesus, with the flame coming out and the sword through it. Yeah. And the first letters of the Greek alphabet, the word Jesus on the heart. And, you know, what this means is that in a sense, the way I directed the scene was that the apostles see it. They all see it. He doesn't do it, but they see it.
This is my heart. Take it. God is inside of us. Devil is outside us in the world all around us. We'll pick up an axe and cut the devil's throat. We'll fight him wherever he is. In the sick, in the rich, even in the temple. I'll lead you. If you have sheep, give them away. If you have a family, leave them.
When you grow up in a household that has the exposed heart of Christ, often with a crown of thorns.
The crown of thorns, yes.
It seems to me in some way that's a kind of fatalistic thing.
Oh, yeah.
All it seems to say what you must do is bleed for the awfulness of the world, the kind of anguish of the world.
Yeah, but also what it is a watching my mother and father deteriorate in the past 10 years. And visiting my mother in the hospital one night, a friend of us came in, and she was losing it a little bit, the head, but she was, this is what I heard growing up all the time, and I saw it in the streets. Basically, I mean, I hope it doesn't sound pretentious, but the idea was, the woman asked her, how are you feeling? She goes, well, what can I tell you? We were put on this earth to suffer. Hmm. Once you know that, it's not that bad.
Is that what you think?
Yeah. You know, but that's why I say, I hope it doesn't sound pretentious, but that's what I grew up seeing. And hearing a lot. She wasn't the only one who said that. And I saw them suffer.
My granny always said, but I never believed her.
Oh, yeah. Once you get used to it, it's like, when you say, okay, that's going to be this amount of pain. Okay, now that amount of pain, that's going to be hard to take, but I might get through it. And it's just a matter of gauging yourself, you know, and systematically getting through the hurdles. And once you understand that, you could probably get through.
Martin, it's been absolutely lovely talking to you, and I hope Kundun does really well.
I hope so, too. Thank you.
Bloke, yeah.